Start?
Yeah, whenever you're ready. But okay. People aren't here yet. I don't know how long you want to wait for them.
Well, let's give another 5 minutes.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, yeah. Yeah, how you doing?
Good.
It is going to be a good day. Yeah.
Yeah, and if you get a chance at some point, pray for us.
I will,
release,
yeah.
Just release what you
I will. Okay.
It's important.
Yeah, I will. I was kind of going to do at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Okay. I've got, I asked them if they could play The Blessing, you know, that song, you know, and then I was only going to speak like a half an hour and tie everything up and then spend however long it takes after that, play that song for 5 minutes and just get the atmosphere set and then do some praying and ask him if he'll come up and pray also and just kind of tie it up like that. What do you think about that? That'd be good? Yeah. And I'll have Jeff come up and do the Hebrew blessing in Hebrew and then we'll, if that's... He said he wasn't sure he could get the YouTube to play on the internet because it might have a copyright fringe or something. But
really? Do
they have your scriptures?
Yes.
Good.
Thanks. They said that. So I said, well, if you can at least play it here. He wasn't sure they could get the audio there. You know, I don't know. It was one of those guys back there. I'm not really sure. You might want to check if you need to, but... Good morning.
Hi there, how you doing?
Good, how are you? Good. Hi there. So, I'm sorry, let me just interrupt because I'm going to have to be up there and I don't want to forget to tell you this. He just asked me, Rick just asked me if sometime we could pray and release what we have for these people. So I was wondering, like at the end of the day, I've got the last session, so maybe just I'll cut it short, you know, a little bit, and I thought I'd have them play the blessing song, you know, that one, and just kind of set the atmosphere and have Jeff do the Hebrew blessing, and then maybe we could just pray after that and see what God will do. So, that good?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
You just got recruited, I guess.
Yeah, you just got recruited.
Well, at the end of the day, you're going to do the Hebrew blessing. I asked him this morning, but it was when he just rolled out of bed, so... No, it's okay. I won't even notice it up there. But if it's for a little further away, then I don't, it doesn't come back at me so bad. Thank you, honey. I think my glasses are up there. I'm kind of lost without them. Thank you. A lioness roars, right? Jump up and knock the devil off, right? And start growling up there. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, and I'm going to let him describe the Nehesh and the serpent because he's got the red dragon background for all of that stuff. So I'll just, and it's going to take, that'll take a little bit of time probably. So I don't know, we'll see. And no pork.
No,
you can do
chicken.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning, online people and in-house people. How's it been so far? Yeah, it's been so good and so deep and amazing, and my head's been swirling like, wow, all this stuff.
Oh, I thought that was just me swirling.
Oh, I thought you were going to say, I thought that was just normal.
No. Am I on? It says on. Says on.
There it is.
Here we go. Yes, I wouldn't say my head's swirling, but I would say, boy, there's a lot of stuff here that I just need to take in and probably watch this again.
Yes.
Because it's so
good.
It's so good. It's so deep. But you know, as deep as it is, our speakers really have brought it to us in a way that's very simple to receive. Anybody else feeling like that?
Yeah.
There's no heaviness to it. There's almost a lightness and giving you the ability to say, well, yeah, I can see that. And it doesn't feel uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm. Amen. It's good. And I was telling our staff last week that maybe talking about spiritual warfare, that part of it, and demonic things is maybe not your most favorite thing. Some of you, maybe it is if you're really called to that. But I know that what's going on in the earth right now, I was thinking this morning, maybe because I told our staff, maybe God is preparing us. But I wonder if all the stuff going on and evil, horrible, terrible things with children, I wonder if some of them will come here for ministry and we need to be equipped, because if they came right now, I know some stuff, but I would be... Yeah, so maybe he's preparing us for that. And for kids, for anybody, it's worth it. I was going to say for kids, it's worth it. For anybody, it's worth it. But you know what I mean. So who knows what he's preparing us for.
Well, I agree with you. I believe that we are the healing rooms of the Santa Maria Valley. Our valley is supposed to, a valley carries. You go down in the valley and it carries. So I know Herb and I got a word 10 years ago, but the Lord spoke this to us 10 years ago, and we keep getting these prophetic words, is that we're going to be ministering to Hollywood. Now, if you see everything that's going on in Hollywood right now and the breakdown of Hollywood, guess what we're going to be getting? Yeah. We're going to be getting the broken. So we need to know, and this is not just your simple, I need some healing. We're talking some ugly stuff. Yeah. So this is needed.
Yes, yeah, so... We are thankful that the Lord brought Dave and Sue here for these few days to impart. And, you know, it's interesting, even while both of them are talking, even if it's sharing a story, God's teaching through that. I hear things and I think, oh, I needed to hear that. Or, yeah, that helps tie together the pieces. So it's been so good. So, Sue, why don't you come on over?
Yay!
And we just want to bless you and thank you for coming. And I love Sue's style. And I've actually, Rick and I got some ministry from her a few years, three, four, something years ago. And it was so good and so full of knowledge. But also, like they were both saying, way beyond knowledge, because you can only learn so much, but revelation. And so I like the revelatory ministry part of it, because you need the knowledge and then you step into revelation. And so the mixture or the combination is so good. So thank you so much for coming, and God bless you.
Amen. Let's open a prayer. Always a good idea to open a prayer. So, Father God, we invite your presence here now. We invite your spirit. Jesus, we invite you to come and just take charge of this time that we have together. And Lord, we push back anything of hell that would try to come against it. Would you just cause the atmosphere to become heaven's atmosphere, that anything that is not of you has got to dissipate and go in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we, Father, invite your revelation knowledge. We invite your presence, your love, your joy, and your peace to come and bless our speakers. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen.
Amen. Love you guys. Love you too. All right. Anybody into singing this morning? Everybody stand up for a minute, okay? I want to teach you a song. It's Shabbat. Right? And Shabbat Shalom. And you know the word Shalom, it's got a list of things here. It doesn't just mean hello and goodbye, although when you're in Israel, that's what you're going to say to people. Shalom. Come on, let me hear it. Shalom.
Shalom.
And it means peace and harmony and wholeness and prosperity, completeness, welfare, and tranquility. All of that in that little word. So today is Shabbat. It's Saturday. And so the song is Shabbat Shalom. Can everybody say that? Shabbat Shalom. And it goes like this. Shabbat Shalom. If you know it, sing it. Good. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Hey, Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Hey, Shabbat, Shabbat. Shabbat, Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shabbat. Shabbat, Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat, Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat, 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 Shabbat Shalom. Hey! You can tell I'm not in the choir, but hey, I like to sing. Oh, Shabbat Shalom, everybody. We are Messianic believers. And so we do a lot of the Jewish traditions and holidays and everything, and we believe Yeshua is our Messiah. There we go. So let's pick up where we left off yesterday, and we're going to be doing a little journey through Exodus. And this is really where a conflict between the kingdoms is really, really evident. And what I'd like to do is, while we're going through these 10 plagues, they're all familiar to you. I want to tell you the gods that are behind the plagues in the Egyptian mythology. But I also want you to be thinking about what gods are in America and what gods are in our individual lives while we're going through these. Because as you'll see, by the time we get to the 10th plague, God did everything with the Hebrews that he's really doing with America, but in little different ways of plagues, okay? So you'll see where Pharaoh had a chance to repent and be redeemed and his head took over every time. So we're going to start. First of all, I want to tell you my friend in Israel. She's an intercessor. And she had two angels visit her not long ago. And she said those angels told her that we are in a pivotal moment with a monumental task ahead of us. A pivotal moment with a monumental task ahead of us. So what would that mean? Pivotal? What's a pivot? Something that can be turned, right? But you're not going to do it easy. It's like your car stalled and the power steering went out. Monumental task to keep your car on the road without power steering, especially if you're in the mountains. And you're at a switchback. Oops, sorry about that. Glasses get in the way. So my question to you individually is, what is God saying to you in this pivotal time? And what monumental task is he giving you? Because we're the church. And it's not like you can come to the healing rooms or some building and that's going to be where you get your monumental task. Your fires get lit before you get here. And then when you come together, it's like a little charcoal fire, you know? You get these little things and you bring them together and it has really hot fire. But if your fire has to be lit when you get here, how big's your fire going to be? And when that briquet gets taken away from the big fire, it'll burn if it doesn't have another source of heat, correct? That'll just burn out. So where are you at individually? And I'm not just speaking body of Christ. We know where that's at. But there will be a separation. And if you don't know what you believe, you'll be swayed. And the deception's going to get so strong that the Lord says out of his mercy, he'll shorten the times. Right? So the very elect don't get deceived. And who knows where we're at, but there's a whole lot of deception out there right now. And, you know, sometimes it's just really hard to know who to believe. You know, Dave mentioned it. We got prophets saying one thing over here and one thing over there, and they seem to be on opposite sides of the scale. And yet we need to learn how to balance everything. We need to learn how to balance loving God and loving people. Because while we should love everybody, we can't love them if they don't repent. I mean, not in the ooey-gooey way. We love them with a God love. But we don't pet their sins because we don't want to offend them. That's not love. That's sending them straight to hell and letting them think it's okay. So we don't have a lot of hard preaching. I mean, I don't find it anyway from our pulpits. And people don't come. They don't want to hear it. But I have found one thing. The broken and the destitute want to hear that. And they know real when they see it. They know if you're real. They know if you're playing a game. They know if you're just trying to put another notch on your belt because that's another soul that you can say you saved. Well, you know what? We don't save them anyway. Holy Spirit does. So, okay, all of that. I'll stop. All right, so I read a thread on Twitter recently. And it said the witches, I follow some of these guys because they're really interesting. I get a lot of little tidbits. And it said, I hope the church doesn't wake up and start to pray because that messes up our plans. Hello. What does that say about us? Let me read that to you again. This is from a bona fide witch. I hope the church doesn't wake up and start to pray because that messes up our plans. So I want to go through Exodus because there's a pattern here that tells us about the supernatural world around us. You know, strength is the ability to withstand attack. Let me say that again. Strength is the ability to withstand attack. And supernatural attacks have been unleashed upon us in America in many forms. We've got COVID, which if you're following the stats, you know where they're at. And if you don't, you should do your own research. We have economic losses to a lot of businesses, and there are a lot of small businesses. It's not the big corporate businesses. Why? Because it's the small businesses. We got a lot of fear. A lot of people are just afraid. In fact, I read a, it was, I wrote it down here someplace. I'll read it to you. It was from the Wall Street Journal this morning. It was a banner. If I can find it. If I can, I'll run across it. Well, anyway, it said something about fear being as much of a pandemic as the COVID itself. And so what spirit is behind that? That's not just about the disease. There's a supernatural thing going on here. My friends and I were talking. We were there like, man, even though we saw convergence years ago, we never really thought that perhaps there would be a pandemic coming through the way that the movie showed it. And if you watch the movies, is this going to lead to Hunger Games? You know, do they want to depopulate? I mean, we know they want to depopulate the earth. They've told us 90%. They're not hiding it. So we're living in pretty interesting times. We're watching men and women beat and kill each other. Yeah, who wants to watch that stuff? I mean, that's real death. That's not a movie. We don't have any school going on, most of our country. What does that do to our young people? And how many young people are left at home to educate themselves while their parents have to be out working? And on top of that, some of that we can look at and say, well, that's really good because it gets them out of their comfort zone. But to be honest, unless you're a Christian homeschooling, it's not good for these kids. Almost overnight, our world changed. And almost overnight, maybe less than 2 months, maybe 2 to 3 months, the Hebrews' world changed after they had been working in Egypt for 400 years. So as Moses and Aaron obeyed God, God performed miracles. And God answered prayer. Yesterday, I said there are many leaders today behind the scenes that haven't been revealed yet. Moses had been revealed. He had been a general. He had been to Ethiopia. He had done great conquests there under Pharaoh before he left Pharaoh. But Aaron, he was probably just work. He was maybe a priest, but he was working in the mud pits along with everybody else probably. He was hidden. And Moses came out and said, he'd been a general. He comes out and says, God, I can't go do this. I stutter. Well, no problem. I'll get Aaron. And there's going to be a lot of Aarons coming out, people we'd never heard of. And you're going to know the truth of what they say by how it hits your spirit, not by other prophets saying it's true or not true. Pay attention. You'll be able to tell. Something will go, I don't like this, but yeah, it's right. Just pay attention. If the word comes true, it's a prophet, probably. Could be a false prophet, too, for that matter, because some of theirs come true also. But you'll know, because the Holy Spirit will tell you. I'm kind of excited about that, to tell you the truth. Because we're going to talk to other people and say, hey, did you hear so-and-so? What do you think about that? They're going to say, you know what? I didn't really like what happened, but it really hit my spirit. Someone watch and see. You can tell by the way I talk, I'm not a pre-tribber. You know what I mean by that? I'm a pan-tribber. It means pre, mid, or post. It's all going to pan out in the end. I don't know. I'm going to live my life like I have the rest of my life, and I'm going to live to the fullest for my destiny, but I'm going to prepare like Yeshua, Jesus, can come back today. And that's a good way to live, I think. So anyway, let's look at scripture. And I'm going to be in Exodus 6 through 10. I probably won't get through it all this morning. But let's look at 6:9. This is really interesting. Moses spoke to the children of Israel. And this was after the burning bush. This was after the Lord told them what was going to happen. It was in Exodus 5. They made their first trip to Pharaoh, let my people go. And in Exodus 6, the sons of Israel were not listening to Moses. And this is an interesting reason. It said Moses spoke to the children of Israel, but they did not heed Moses because of anguish of spirit and cruel bondage. My translation says, because they are broken. How about that? They did not listen to him because of their broken spirit. As we're looking across our country today, even in the body of Christ, how many people's spirits are becoming broken? And how many people have had false prophecies spoken over them and they have been capped off? And they just can't get over it. I had a phone conversation, the phone ministry, with a world platform man not too long ago. You would know him if I said his name. And he'd had a false word spoken over him 30 years ago that he just couldn't quite get over. He couldn't quite get over the fear of what that prophecy had said to him. And it was totally and completely not true. The interesting part was the woman that gave the ministry, or the word, she didn't do it on purpose. She was an intercessor. Maybe she picked up on something and her mind got mixed up in it. It's hard to tell. But shortly after that, as far as we can tell by the timing, she got really, really sick and was taken and just never got back into the flow of the ministry. Look how the devil twisted that and kept two people from achieving their full destiny for decades. Isn't that crazy? I mean, one plunged ahead and did it in spite of, with all this stuff over his head, and the other felt so bad after she got sick and she wondered about it and never trusted God enough to pick it up and brush it off and go back in. That's the broken. That's right in our own circles. It happens all the time. And so I'm going to encourage you, you get a word spoken over you you don't agree with, don't think it's just you, because God will speak to you, your spirit will rise up and you'll know, even if you don't like it. Dave told Seth, didn't like it, but he knew it was God. Be careful with strangers. I don't care what their names are. If you don't know them and don't know their life, how do you know? I'm just going to throw that out to you because it's true. We have a lot of wolves in the body of Christ. Wolves. The ones that will snarl and eat you up. And they're used by the enemy. Unwittingly, a lot of times. So what am I saying to you? Not to trust everybody? No, I'm just saying pay attention. Get your discernment. Get your discernment level. And don't think it's just you. You know, that's what I used to do all the time. Somebody would come along and say something and I'd think, must be me. Must be me. What don't I like about that person? I need to go back and repent. This is really wrong. Sue, you've just gone over the edge here. You just don't trust anybody anymore. Well, working with these folks, I kind of got to that place, to be honest. Kind of came back in balance a little bit. But when I first started out, I was like, oh, I don't know. But you'll know. And so when, take it back to the Lord. That's what Hezekiah did, right? He took the letter back to God. He spread it out in the temple and said, God, this is what they're saying. Can you help? Is this true? So, if I was a mom, that's what I'd be telling you to do. Okay, so. Anyway, let's look at Exodus 7. So the Lord said to Moses, I have made you a God to Pharaoh, or as God to Pharaoh, and Aaron, your brother, will be your prophet. So he goes into Pharaoh, and you got to remember that Pharaoh was looked at as God, being God incarnate over Egypt. Y'all know that? I'm going to give you some mythological background, okay? So all the gods of Egypt were inside of him, and he was God incarnate. So it was up to him to make sure the gods did what they were supposed to do. And when they didn't, it was his fault. How would you like that kind of title and handle on you? Yeah, it's really hard, right? You know, Pharaoh was offended by God's servants. And yesterday I said, when God made human beings, there was something on the other side offended, something on the supernatural side. So let's just put that delineation in right now to start with. And so we read in 7:11. Go down to that scripture. I'm going to jump right by. Because you know the story. I just want you to look at the gods behind it. Signs and wonders have always been the credential of God's servants. Why is that? so that everyone will know that Yahweh, Elohim, El, whatever you call him, Adonai, is the God of all gods. There's no God like him. No God close to being like him. No COVID God close to being like him. David talked about fear yesterday. No fear God comes close to being like him. No shame comes close to being like God. And so Pharaoh called the wise men and the sorcerers, verse 11, and the magicians of Egypt, and they did the same thing he did. Imagine he threw his rod down. Moses threw his rod down, became a serpent. They threw their rods down. They were wise men. They knew the occult arts. They were sorcerers. And they were the only ones that had access to the hidden books of the king, who had all the occult arts in there, the magic formulas. And no one else could consult them except those folks. But in verse 12, we read, theirs became serpents, but Aaron's rods swallowed up their rods. Now look, God's power is always greater than Satan's. And the rod is the staff, is authority. It's a metaphor for authority. So God's power was greater than Satan's power. God will always allow the occult to show their power, and they might even flaunt it. It may come in your face. But when we use our authority and we throw down our authority, guess what? It's going to swallow up theirs. Everybody okay? Okay. So Moses is told to go by God, is told by God to go to Pharaoh when he comes out of the waters of the Nile River. Now, the Nile River was important to the Egyptian people because it flooded their plains and gave them a lot of fertile ground. He told Aaron, to raise his staff and stretch out his hand over the waters of Egypt, over their rivers, over their streams, over their pools, and over their ponds, so that the water becomes blood, even in the wooden and stone containers all throughout Egypt. Now, if Pharaoh was God incarnate of Egypt, and it was believed he was a god, they hated blood. So now, all of a sudden, all of their water becomes blood. And you have to remember, there were hundreds and hundreds of Egyptian gods over there. And the Hapi, H-A-P-I, was the god of the Nile. He was in charge, God was in charge of making sure that the Nile got flooded every year. And so the magicians also dug. Now, this is interesting. It said the people dug next to the waters of the Nile to get the water. So it was just the water in the Nile, maybe, or in their containers that turned to blood? Because where did the magicians get water to turn to blood? They had to get it from someplace. If all the water was blood, there had to be some water someplace, and it said they dug along the river to find the water. Now look, folks. It may look like the God of the evil is winning. And it may look like the Holy Spirit is drying up. But when you dig your well alongside the river that's already been polluted, you're going to find some good water. Holy Spirit will saturate you. Holy Spirit will be with you. Holy Spirit is going to build you up and bless you, even in hard times. Amen? So the second plague comes along. We're going to jump down to Exodus 8, 3 and 4 here. And Adonai tells Moses, stretch out your staff over the rivers, canals, pools, and cause frogs to come up all over Egypt. So the magicians did the same thing with their art. And then you can read, the river will bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall come up and go into your house. They're going to be in your bedrooms. They're going to be on your bed. Think about this. Come on, if this was your house. Come on, they're in your house. They're in your bedroom. They're on your bed. They're in the houses of your servants, on your people, in your ovens. Check this out. They had these holes they would dig, and they would have the... this earthen thing they would put in there, they'd build a fire, they'd put their dough up along it, and that's how they made their bread. But the frogs were there. Frogs are everywhere. They couldn't get the frogs out of there. How unclean and yucko would that be? And they'll be in your kneading bowls. You can't even get them out of the bowls in your cupboards. Think about that. So then the magicians come along, and they say, you know what? We're going to do the same thing. What did they do? They made the problem worse. They just multiplied the frogs, right? Now Hecate, H-E-K-E-T, was the god who is pictured with the head of a frog. He is the god of fertility, water, and renewal. Think about that. So now we got this guy. It doesn't say the magicians could stop the plague. It says they could only make it worse. Right? So Satan can do miracles. He will, and he does. Or his henchman does. I'm just going to call him Satan, and just it's the whole gamut of evil. But he's limited in his power. Remember that. You know, we're hearing David tell us. Yeah, what are you going to do about it? You can only do what God lets you do. We see that in Job, right? Have heart, people. You're going to know your enemy. I pray we all see what's going on with the war of the gods over our country and over our lives. Because when we're living in a country, in a region, and there's an occult force in the invisible atmosphere, if we think we're not affected by that, we're crazy, because we are. However, we don't have to cower down. We can become the soldiers God always wanted us to be. And we can fight for the kingdom of God and advance it. That's why the church is in the state it's in right now. Because we just sat down and said, well, either we're going to get raptured out of here and it's not going to matter. Everybody else can take care of it. Or we just turned our heads because it's too painful to look at. Who wants to look at children being murdered in rituals and blood sacrifices and trafficked? Nobody does. Who wants to hear the stories? Nobody does. Makes your heart hurt too much to think about little 3- and 4-year-olds, 2-year-olds, 7-year-olds, 14-year-olds. Boys and girls, not just girls. That's horrible. And we have some that are bringing people out and doing things with them. And thank God for that. But there's so much more to be done. And you know what? If we can't do anything else, we can at least be praying. Don't leave it all up to the intercessors, because each one of you are intercessors. Okay, so back to Hecate. So the plea for mercy in Pharaoh verse 8 was, pray to the Lord, he's going to take these frogs from me and my people. I'll let your people go. Well, that was a lie. So Moses said, when would you like this to happen? And so he answers, tomorrow. Now, one of the things that's amazing to me is all the way through these 10 plagues, God gave the people a heads up. He said, tomorrow this is going to happen, except for one. But tomorrow this is going to happen. We are getting a lot of heads up, folks. Tomorrow this is going to happen. Well, maybe it's not when the sun goes down and comes up. But we see the future. We read the word. We just don't have the exact timeline. But when you see these things begin to happen, look up. Jesus said, for your redemption is going to draw nigh. Right? So, this is a war of the gods. And God used Moses as a true representative. Moses was flowing in the supernatural, and if any of his words failed, then guess what? His God was going to be defeated. And Pharaoh's God would win. That's a good word, isn't it? Look at that. So my question is, how broken are we as a body, as the body of Christ? How broken in spirit are we? Truly. As a corporate body, how hurt are we? Because we're not seeing what we so long to see and take part in what we've so longed to take part in. We need healing. We need healing from our fear and our shame. We need healing to be whole and complete. And God knows that, and he's going to do it. Everybody okay? So Moses prayed, and the frogs departed, and they remained in the river Nile only. It was a really simple prayer. He wasn't afraid God wouldn't remove the frogs, and he didn't seem to be too concerned about how he prayed. He just knew God would do it. He simply heard from God and believed him. Can I tell you, there's no model of praying except the one that the Lord gave us, the Father gave us, you know, our Father who art in heaven. So even when you're praying for broken people and you're ministering to them, there's really no prayer that's a model prayer. You pray from your heart. You pray for what you believe God is showing you and telling you. And guess what? He does the job. He does the work. He really does. I was taking a young lady through some inner healing and deliverance, and we were breaking off some generational things, and she had a leg that was turned out like this. Her hip was, she would walk like this. Her hip was malformed when she was born, and God said to her mom, I'm gonna heal her. So when the doctors wanted to operate on her, God's going to heal her. So now this lady's 30-some years old. She has a baby of her own, and she's still walking like this. So she comes, and we're just going, you know, Lord, forgive the iniquity of her generations, you know, back to however far you need to, and, you know, just the normal thing we pray. And I look down, and she's like this, both feet sticking straight like that. And I'm thinking, maybe it's just the way she's sitting. So she's like, can you get up and walk? Yeah, sure. So she gets up. Now, she never gives me an ounce of emotion, right? And she walks feet straight ahead. I said, can you take off your shoes and kind of run around the table? Because I'm still like, let me just see this. And she did. I said, well, look at you. I think God just touched and healed you. And she goes, wow. We don't need to get all stressed out about what to pray, how to pray, how's it going to sound, am I doing the right words. It's God that does it. And he kind of reads your heart. You know, he's kind of a heart-to-heart God. He'll read your heart. So anyway, let's go on. So the frogs died, and they gathered them into heaps, and guess what? The land started to stink. And again, Pharaoh hardened his heart. Now we get to the third plague. And I want to say something about this. I just heard this morning that a whole bunch of elephants are dying. A whole bunch of them. They don't even know why. Hundreds of them. They're just finding them dead. And what about these fish that are being washed up dead on shore? There's thousands of them. Thousands and thousands of them. Even in the fish farms. I thought about that when I read this. The frogs stunk. I'll bet you those animals are stinking someplace. Just because it's not happening right here doesn't mean there aren't other people seeing this type of stuff. And what's going on? Why are all these animals dying? Tens of thousands of them around the world. Why are the fish dying? Could it be a plague? Just asking. I don't know. Throwing that out there. The third plague was the dust of the land became lice. And Geb was the god of the earth. And he supported the physical part of the world. Now, can you imagine, just think, anybody been to the desert? Okay, so anybody been to the beach? Okay, so just close your eyes a minute and think about all those little grains of sand. And if every one of those grains of sand became either a lice or a gnat or a mosquito, the ground would, like, move, don't you think? Would it just really be crawling? This was the third one. Can you imagine if there were mosquitoes in that mess? My gosh. And they were on animals, too. It wasn't just on people. And this Geb guy was utterly helpless to protect Egypt. And even the magicians couldn't duplicate this miracle with their witchcraft, even though they tried. And they said, this is the finger of God. And so the occult gets to a place where they say, you know what? This is the finger of God. And this was only the third plague. Let's see, where are we at here? The fourth plague was the flies. Beelzebub, you ever hear him? Yeah, Lord of the Flies. And he was supposed to protect the people from uncleanness. You know, flies are kind of yucko. And this is kind of disastrous to the temple worshipers because they had to have clean stuff in there, and then they can't worship their gods if things aren't clean. So Moses goes back to Pharaoh and proclaims, let my people go that they might serve me. Otherwise, there's going to be swarms of flies. But I'm going to make a distinction with my people in Goshen. Listen to this carefully. We would metaphorically represent the people in Goshen. We know the Lord. Those were the Lord's people, right? So they had to go through a few plagues. But here, God makes a distinction. They will be exempt. So you will see that I am the Lord. That's what Moses said to Pharaoh. God watches over his people so that those people in the occult can make a distinction and know what God is God. And you can trust that. Because some of those folks are just looking for power. And they're just looking for somebody to serve that will give them power and control. But some of them truly want to have that hole in their heart filled. And they come looking for that. Not all of them are sent on assignment to destroy us. Some are. But not all of them. And when they're hurting bad enough, they come. So in Scripture, it says, I'm putting a division between my people and yours, and tomorrow you will see. And that word division is the same Hebrew word, P-E-D-U-T-H, and in Psalm 130 and Psalm 119, it's translated as redemption. Good, huh? I'm going to put redemption between my people and yours. God is going to put redemption, is putting redemption between God's people and others. You're going to see that. You're going to see people that you're like, what? What decisions are you making? What are you saying? And they'll come against you. Some of you have already had that happen. Some of you are feeling pretty lonely because even the members of your family think you're crazy. And the majority of, I hate to tell you this, but the majority of the body of Christ is going to think you're crazy too. And it's just because they don't understand. But it's even bigger than that, just like Pharaoh. Their heart starts to get there, but their heads say, no, I'm going to make this a logical thing. I'm going to look for all the logic in the supernatural, and I'm going to find a way to make it logical. So, in Exodus 8:20, it says, there came a grievous swarm of flies. The land was corrupted by reason of the swarm of flies. So Pharaoh starts to bargain. He goes, well, you can practice your religion here. Go sacrifice to your God. But Moses argues for the people. Hey, look, you know how much these Egyptians hate blood. They're going to stone us and kill us when they see us sacrificing to our God because of the blood. Think about that. Because of the blood of Yeshua, how many people would like to stone you? People in your own, if that was a type of a discipline today, how many people that you know in your own family would like to just say, hey, let me just flag you a couple times and get you down to where you get your senses back. It's hurtful. It's hurtful even for folks that are in a congregation where there's a lid on your congregation and you're not allowed to flow in your giftings, you're not allowed to be moving in what you know the supernatural is, and what you know is right. I'd encourage you, go find a place to worship where you can get a hold of the living God, because we're going to need all of that to make it through. All right, fifth plague. Okay, the plague upon the livestock. We don't know whatever plague it was. Let me see which scripture it is. It's 9:6. And the scripture says, all the cattle of Egypt died, yet the cattle of the sons of Israel, not one died. And when Pharaoh went out and asked about this, and he said there wasn't even as much as one of the cattle of the sons of Israel that died. Imagine that, not even one. But look at the huge economic disaster it was for everybody else, okay? Their food was affected, their farming was affected, their transportation, because their horses died, it says livestock. And again, there was a difference here. Everything in Goshen lived. Everything that Pharaoh had and in his people did not. Now, what do you think they would be tempted to steal the Goshen's livestock? What do you think they would be tempted to, after all, here goes their food supply, here's their transportation, the economics are turned upside down. Are you afraid of what's coming economically? Do you think for a heartbeat God's not going to take care of you? Is there going to be something economically? Yeah, there will be. The last half of this year, we're going to be borrowing over a couple $1 trillion. Come on, if we ran our households like that, we'd be broke. And who are we borrowing it from? Whoever you borrow from's got control over you. If you don't pay it back, they're going to do something like take your house away. Do you think for a heartbeat, if the banks crash, God can't multiply the few crumbs you have in your house? Do you think for a heartbeat you're storing up just for yourself? If God allows there to be a surplus, it's not for just you. It's going to be for others that don't have. And one of the gods I believe God is breaking down in America is the God of greed. If you go to another culture, other than the Western culture, you don't find people greedy at all. In fact, there's this story I heard, kind of like a joke, but it's kind of true. So this person from America goes to a Central America, South America country, and they're poor. You know, they don't have a lot of stuff there. The guy goes out and he fishes every morning. He gets done mid-afternoon, he comes home, he takes a siesta, he spends the night with his family, having a good time, children playing games. And this American or whoever comes through and says, hey, look at that load of fish, you got a lot of fish there. Why don't you buy another boat? You get two boats, you'll have twice as much. And then you can get three. And then you can buy a fish factory. And you can process your own fish, make lots of money. And then you'll have, and the guy says, well, at the end of that, what do I have? I said, well, you'll have time to spend with your wife and your kids. He said, well, why do I want to do all that when I can do it here? Different way of thinking. Different way of thinking. So it's interesting to me. Oh, so I'm sorry. Let's go back to this plague of livestock. And so Hathor was the god there, and he was pictured as having the head of a cow. Check that out. But this god who had the head of a cow was powerless to protect the animals against the plague of Yahweh. So it's interesting to me that all the way through this, God gave Pharaoh a heads up. He kept saying tomorrow, giving him time to repent, giving him time to make some changes. But then he'd think about it and say, nope, not going to do that. And his heart would get hardened. How many times have we done that? How many times has God said something to us? This is what I want you to do. But it's not immediate. I know I've done it, and I know everybody probably has done it one time or another, but I want you to do this. And I get thinking about it, and I think myself right out of the supernatural. Anybody ever done that? I sure have. And then I'm sorry. Okay, so 10 years ago, they were making movies about this pandemic. What are they showing us? You know, people coming out of the occult say, we warn you what's coming. The Illuminati says this. We warn you what's coming. So then we're not held at fault. If you don't pay attention, that's your fault. It's interesting. Watch the movies. You're just kind of going to see. Watch the toys that are coming out. I think Hasbro, I think that's the name of the company, just pulled a toy that they had put out there, a very perverse toy for little children. Thank God they pulled it. Thank God he listened to our prayers. When we see these things, we need to be praying. And you know, it was really, really exciting to me. I had sent the article to both of my young children who have one child and one grandchild who has a great-grandchild. Can't believe I'm that old. Anyway, I sent that article to them, and I said, be careful, don't let this toy, you know, check this toy out. And they, we both already saw that. Isn't that disgusting? So I was really happy that they're on the front cutting edge. But don't be afraid to send those things to your kids or your grandkids, because they don't always know, they don't always see, and they're not really sometimes on the same page we're at. And we need to give them our wisdom. We need to be pouring into their life, whether they want to listen or not. You know, I'm their grandma. And they'll listen to, they might not listen to me. They just think, ah, grandma's crazy. You know, she's over there someplace. But somehow that seed gets dropped into them. So I'd encourage you. There was a young prophet who said that God had his finger on the baby boomer generation, that he was going to use the baby boomer generation mightily in the coming times. That we have a way of thinking, us older folks, that things are done for us, that we kind of can sit around and all we can do is pray. But the truth of the matter is, we understand what it used to be like. We understand what it was when the stores were closed on Sunday so you could have a family day. We understood what it was like when adults were respected and children respected adults. We understood what it was not to have to run our kids around for 40 hours a week to their extracurricular activities. We understood what it was to let a child play and eat dirt. And sit in the back of a pickup while you drove around, not afraid that they're going to die or something, you know? We didn't have them contained with hand sanitizer. And what about the masks? It's crazy. Little children. In a little, you know, I saw a picture somebody had taken from someplace, and it had on this playground squares just painted on the grass, 6 feet square, so the child could just play in the middle of the square and wouldn't be near anybody. And they're like, oh my, it's just craziness. It is not God. God doesn't want us separated from each other. God does not want half of our faces covered so we don't even know who we're talking to and we can't see a smile. God doesn't want us burning or breathing our own waste. It's supposed to go out, not come in. But what do we do when we find ourselves in a situation like we're in right now? And I can't tell you that answer. Everybody has to figure it out for themselves. But one thing I can tell you, these are desperate times. And it happened overnight. But we had 10 years ago. This is tomorrow. But because it was in a movie theater, we thought, that can't happen. It's just somebody. Where do you think they get their ideas from? The spirit realm. Either God invades their imagination, or they're already involved in the occult. And the enemy invades their imagination. And if that wasn't so true, we wouldn't be spending our money to go watch it. When I was in revival, Steve Hill was good at saying, hey, you got videos in your house? Back in the days of videos. You play them on that church wall, then you keep them. If you can't play them on that church wall, you throw them out. They don't belong in your house. They got a curse word. They curse in Jesus Christ. They're saying GD this and GD that and F this and F that. You want that on the church wall? It gets inside of you. It after a while, your conscience gets seared. So what do we do about that? Well, first of all, you just get your own life cleaned up, right? Take a log out of your own eye. Then pray. Pray like you've never prayed before. We really need it right now. Okay, so I'm going to keep going or I'm not going to get done. In Exodus 9:18, we have the seventh. Oh, we forgot the sixth plague, sorry. God told Moses to take handfuls of ashes, and I think it's in 9:10-11. God told Moses to take handfuls of ashes from the furnace and stand before Pharaoh and scatter them towards heaven and cause boils that break out on sores and on the beast. Now, these sores were the Hebrew word shekin, to burn, ulcerate, boil, or botch. Ouch. Think about it. Matt, what if you were all covered with those boils? Maybe that's what Job had, where he took those potsherds, you know, and scraped the pus off of there. But even the magicians had them. And so that was a real personal judgment by God against the god of Isis, which was medicine. You ever hear of Isis before? Because it made them unclean, and you couldn't minister rituals to their gods and be in the Pharaoh's presence if you were unclean. The seventh plague we find in Exodus 9:18, and that was Nut, the goddess of the sky. So we're back. Yahweh is making it clear that it was only him that raised Pharaoh up, but God is greater. So in the announcement of this plague, God told Moses to gather the livestock and the servants out of the field so the hail didn't kill them. This is 9:20, you guys. So get this, among Pharaoh's servants, think of the revival we've been hearing about coming, this harvest. Among Pharaoh's servants, those who feared the Lord brought their cattle and servants into their homes. But those that did not regard the word of the Lord left theirs outside. And here was the harvest coming in. Here were the unbelievers seeing the power of the God of Israel. Seeing the power of our God, the unbelievers will come. But these folks went through some stuff. These folks had to stay where they belonged, where there was no plagues, and watch it from a distance. What about that? When these plagues get intense enough, and our cities are being burned, do we just stay where we're at and watch and pray? Just a thought. But the harvest is going to come because they're going to see God taking care of you. And it's going to be members of your family. It's going to be friends that have been laughing at you. It's going to be those folks that call you for prayer but never want to come to the Lord. They just want you to pray for them. Isn't that what Pharaoh did? Hey, pray for me. Let this stuff stop. Okay. God listened to Moses and stopped the stuff, right? How many of us have people like that in our circle? We do. We all do. So stay strong, my friends, and be encouraged. When you fear the Lord, we're going to see that harvest of souls. I have heard about this harvest of souls coming in for a very long time. And I never felt like it was going to come in through good times. The reason I never felt that is because it didn't work in how many decades now. I didn't think it was going to work in the future. I always felt there were going to be hard times coming. But out of the hard times is where the harvest is going to be. And you know what? In a harvest, you need fish cleaners. Think about getting fish, right? You get fish. Somebody's got to clean the fish. So we got fishermen and men. We have people that are going to clean the fish. We have people that will teach the fish. And it may not be able to be on a platform. Who knows? It might have to be in a different way. I don't know. I hope not. But I don't know. Be ready. And don't be afraid. Know the word, because people are going to need to know it. You got to know how to teach it. You got to know what you believe. And people are going to be afraid, can I tell you? They're already afraid. Do you ever run into somebody at Walmart that just thinks you're the devil? And they scream and they have, the, you know, there's almost like they're manifesting or something. Or how about a bank teller? I've had that happen. Or a checkout person. So, yeah, give them love. Tell them, you know, it's okay. Calm down. I want to speak about Kali for just a minute, who is that Indian god that Dave talked about yesterday. She wears a skirt of severed human arms, a necklace of decapitated heads, earrings of dead children, and often is pictured with her tongue sticking out, dripping blood. Well, back in 2015, this Hindu god was pictured on the side of the Empire State Building, all lit up in lights. Remember that? But in 5 short years later, and she's the god of death and destruction, and at a major port in the United States. 5 years later, where does this plague break out of death and destruction? And the top of the Empire State Building was blinking the red distress signal. What god is that? We think America doesn't have gods? So, here we go. Let's go to the next one, which is the seventh plague. And that what killed these livestock were thunder and hail and fire mixed with hail. And it struck down everything in the fields, every plant of the field, flax, barley. But in God's mercy, spared a couple of crops. So in Exodus 9:27, Pharaoh says, hey, I've sinned this time. The Lord is righteous, and I and my people are wicked. So Pharaoh finally got it. I'm a sinner. But was he really repentant? Was he really sorry he sinned? Or was he just sorry he got caught and everything was getting ruined? How many false salvations do we have in the body of Christ? Simply because if there's no supernatural work, then very few are really in that hour that they're sitting there coming to a true repentance. And people think they're saved, but are they? When they're really pushed, do they have something to hang on to? They can work out their salvation with fear and trembling, sure they can. But how many people just, like a fast food window, just take it and grab it and assume that they're saved when they're really not? And who's supposed to be doing the work? We are, discipling them. It doesn't say anything about going out and saving people. It says go out and make disciples. Salvation is just the first step into God's world. Anyway, I got to hurry up here. I only have a few minutes left. The eighth plague was against Seth, the god of storms and disorder. And this one's really interesting because it was the locust. And they came in such numbers that they covered the whole ground and darkened the sun. Imagine that. 6 to 8 inches thick. You want them in your house walking on them? Crunch, crunch, crunch. Yeah. They ate every plant in the land and all the fruit from the trees that the hail had left. Now you got to remember when the hail came down, it came down with thunders and lightnings and fires. It was quite a scene. So great locust plagues just in the last year. 2 years, actually. In July of this year, Science Alert reported that there were trillions of them that came in and destroyed every crop and pasture they could find in Kenya, Ethiopia, Yemen, and North India. So, but Goshen again was not affected. Now, we don't live in the part of the world where we see these locust things, thank God, but we've had a lot of floods in the Midwest that have wiped out our crops and our grain storage things last year. You should follow some of these news things. They're kind of depressing, but you kind of know why all of a sudden we have plant stuff all over the plant stuff being offered here, there, and someplace else because there's a little bit of a shortage of grain. And then the pigs that got killed in China last year, our food supply is dwindling. So anyway, then Pharaoh says, okay, would it be all right with me? You guys go, you men go, and I'll keep the little ones as collateral. What about pedophilia? Is that what's happening with the plague here? It's not that Pharaoh's going to keep our kids while the men go and, you know, but is pedophilia kind of a plague? The ninth plague was against the god of Ra, the sun god. And this god was supposed to protect from any curse of the sun. Now remember, you've got all these gods that were doing the protecting and all these people coming against Pharaoh saying, this isn't good, this isn't good, this isn't good, it's all your fault. What are we saying about our government? Ah, it must be your fault. Yeah, if only this person was in power, it might be better. We have this huge political thing going on. And people are blaming the government even now because they're not going to get what it looks like another unemployment extension. What's going to happen to all of us if the economics crash and nobody gets anything from the government? That's a scary thought, isn't it? I heard the statistics a little while ago that over 40% of people that rent are going to be like 3 months past due in July. That's a lot of people to turn out homeless if that were to happen. So I don't want to depress you all. I just want to tell you God's for you. So anyway, during this bargaining process, complete darkness. Can you imagine darkness you can feel? I got to hurry. I'm over. But you know, it's interesting. Pharaoh never tried to kill these folks because God probably wouldn't let him. And the 10th plague was against Pharaoh himself, the ultimate power of Egypt. So in this, all the firstborns died, the firstborn of people, the firstborn of animals. And what about depopulating our earth up to 90% that we've been hearing coming from this, just different streams of news? The plan of what they'd like to do. Well, I may tell you something. I don't really care what they plan to do. There's no God that can stand up against our God. There is no God that is going to let his people, whom he loves. Are we going to suffer? Well, yeah, but you know, it used to be, hey, will you pray my dishwasher's broke? No, it's like, come on. Our prayers are going to get a little bit more real, intense. God, I need food. Maybe. And, you know, God could take that little bit and multiply it. Or God, my neighbors are hungry. I only have enough for me. Can you make more for them? You think God won't do that? Or God, I can't go to the doctor. You know, in order to go into a hospital now, you got to have a mask on, you got to have your temperature taken, you got to blah, blah, blah. What's the next step going to be? For a moment, do you think God's going to let our older elder, my mom's in a nursing home right now and I can't get in to see her. But if the Lord would decide to take her, do you think for a moment she's going to be alone? No, she's not. She's going to be surrounded by angels. And he's going to carry her. And he's going to help her. And he's going to take her home where she doesn't have to hurt anymore. Do you think for a heartbeat God is going to abandon his people? No, he's always had a remnant he's watched out after. He's never left the earth without a remnant and his people. The occult is not going to win. The occult will not win. These gods who are driving the occult, and that's my whole point of all of this, and I hope you pick that up. The Exodus was all about defeating the gods that had broken the hearts of the people of Israel. God was all about getting them out of there, but not until he proved he was the God. God is all about delivering us out of our brokenheartedness, but not until he proves he is the God. He's broken down the sports in our country. Think about it. Who are they bowing their knee to? What God are they bowing their knee to? Not the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and not our God. So, Father, we ask you, make it plain to us. Encourage our hearts, Lord. We just took a run through the plagues, which I did in a hurry, but I would love to have spent more time on each one, because there's a story there where everybody was captive, and then there was a distinction, and then there was a harvest, and many of those people in the harvest came out of Egypt with them. And God, so be it for the times we live in now. Father, we pray you would anoint each person here. Father, I pray, Lord God, right now that you would anoint each person here, Lord. Cover us with your blood, Lord. Everybody watching, Lord, cover them with your precious blood, Yeshua Jesus. Everything that your atonement provided for us, Lord God, and give us deep shalom inside of us, that our minds would be clear and would be set on you, Lord. Keep our feet nailed to the highway of holiness and put a rod of steel in our backbone, Lord. And Father, for this thing that's trying to cover our mouth in this year of pay, which means mouth, Lord, I pray, God, this prophetic thing, these masks, Lord God, even if we have to wear a physical mask, that it's not going to be a spiritual mask that keeps our mouth shut. And we thank you for that. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. We have a 10-minute break, so do what you need to do and be back in 10 minutes, okay?
Put your one shoulder, bring it down.
Hey there, hi there, ho there, musketeers. Yeah, hey there, hi there, ho there, musketeers. Yes.
I'm one of those movie people.
Oh,
we were
cool.
Just talking. God talks to me through movies all
good.
The time.
Yeah.
Especially the old ones.
Yeah.
I mean, there's one line sometimes.
A lot of the new movies, the devil speaks to you through.
Oh, Lord, I don't want to. But I'll write down.
Hi there. Yeah, that happens to me a lot. Yeah. Yeah. My wife doesn't like movies, you know, and I said, do you want to go see Wonder Woman? She said, nah, that's just, no, I don't like, she doesn't like movies. And so then she said, well, maybe we should. So we went and watched Wonder Woman. And she usually sleeps through them, right? But there's a scene in Wonder Woman where she says, now I know that only love can save the world. My wife's so prophetic. She was sitting there and she got her phone out of her purse. I said, what are you doing? She said, I'm going to record this. And I said, you can't record movies. She said, I know something's about to happen. And she put her little recorder video on and pointed it up there. Just when Wonder Woman walked out and says, now I know that only love can save the world. Well, Cheryl's always, I mean, she loves everybody. And she clicked it off. And I looked at her and I said, it's way amazing. I said, so you just knew she was about to say something important? She said, I didn't know, but God, obviously God did. Yeah. Oh, good.
I'm so hungry for this. And you know, the Lord spoke to me.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so I have Watchman Nee's book on authority.
Oh, yeah.
But I'm
yeah.
trying to hear God right now.
Yeah, good for you. So you live right in this area?
Yes, or, oh, okay. I live in Valencia.
Okay.
I'm football coach.
Oh, how cool.
He would have loved you, because he had a lot of those one-liners.
Ah,
yeah. But no, he passed away, so I moved up here. I lived here before for 20 years.
Oh, okay.
So I just came back.
Oh,
now.
Good for you. That is where I left off, yeah.
I liked your shirt yesterday. I like this one. You got
oh, good.
Made like that, huh?
Yeah, I do. There's a lady in our church that her and her husband asked if she could buy me shirts. And I said, well, I don't know. I mean, what kind of shirts? She said, I'll shop. I like to shop. I'll buy you shirts. And she's bought me about 30 of these things. I don't know where she gets them, but, you know. So, yeah, we're good to go, right? Yeah, okay, thank you.
Okay, I need to put this place.
Thanks. I'm ready. Okay, Jeff. Let's just do it, right? Uh-huh. Oh, cool. Yeah, that's great. Is he the one you're going to give part of your land to? Is that? Oh, okay, cool. That's wonderful. All right, you want to do this? I'm going to go ahead
and do it. Okay, everybody, we're going to gather back together. And we're going to have Dave Bryan sharing for this next session right before lunch. So bless you, Dave. Welcome. Hi, internet people.
Hi, internet people. All right. How's everybody doing? That's okay. We're supposed to, yeah, let our light shine here. Okay. So let's pray real quick. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your love and your grace. We thank you for your overwhelming victory over sin and death and hell. And Lord Jesus, thank you that you surround us with songs of deliverance and you lead us from victory to victory. We love you and we thank you for all your grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. This is my last time to fire one off. So I'm going to tell you an amazing story. But big guy in the front row there asked me to talk about why Satan is called the devil and what that has to do with anything. So let me start there. I think it's helpful to understand. There are, and Sue's talked about this, but we really have trouble with our concepts of God because they're so, so limited. Years ago, Martin Luther had an ongoing argument with a fellow named Erasmus about the nature of God. And he wrote a big book called The Bondage of Will that talked about their discussion back and forth. But Martin Luther, the reformer, this was his conclusion after years of arguing with this other theologian. He said, your problem, my dear Erasmus, is that your concept of God is entirely too small. I think it's not just Erasmus that struggles with that. But for instance, we tend to think that God, his story started about the same time ours did. That is not true. And so it wasn't like Father, Son, Holy Spirit was just kind of hanging around in space waiting, you know, should we do something yet? Well, not yet. Let's give it some time. And all of a sudden they decide to create the heavens and the earth that we now know. They're eternal beings. We really, our brain taps out on the concept of eternity, going either direction. But God is eternal in both directions. So I want you to remember that our concept of the eternal realm is minuscule. But God is a creator. Now, it's not something that he just does. It's the essence of his being. He creates. Everything he says goes forth from him with creative power. And, if you're around somebody that's creative, there's all kind of little cool things around. Why? Because creativity oozes out of them, right? Well, it's been oozing out of him for a while now. And my point is that we tend to think, oh, an angel, you know, about 6'2", blonde hair, blue eyes. And a demon is, you know, a little horned thing with a forked tail and cloven hooves. And we have all these goofy concepts. I want you to remember something. What we call the week of redemption,
just approximately 7,000-year period of the redemption of mankind is just a blip on the radar screen of eternity. You realize that, right? And so we come into this thing after what's called the cosmic revolt, meaning that Lucifer has already rebelled against God. A third of the star angels and of course, myriads of others that are under the authority structures of those powerful angels had rebelled against God. And that had already happened. So in the Garden of Eden, it wasn't the devil's first week at being backslidden, right? last week I was nearly in charge up there, but got fired, and so I'm down here hanging out in the garden with you. No, it's not like that, okay? So the eternal, well, let's go back to the little blip that we called the time-space continuum. That's what we're living in right now. We won't always live in that. And it's nearly over. But inside of that little speck, there are somewhere between 10 and 50 million species of created things. Think about that. If we just shoot in the middle somewhere about 30 million, that's a heck of a lot of things. Yeah, they're still discovering them all the time, and like, oh, nobody knew about this, nobody knew about that. That's because God is a creator. I used to love to scuba dive, and you get down there deep enough, you see some weird things. And I was always amazed at, like, look what God did. Until there was a self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, which is what scuba means, no human being saw those. For thousands and thousands of years, God did it because it was a cool thing to do, and he's a creator. And he's made all these strange little things that go around with headlamps on and all kinds of weirdness. So I want you to think for a minute, how populated might the eternal realm be? Just think about that. Since God never gets tired of working, and he's a creator. So there are so many kinds of things that there's no way to come up with an accurate catalog of all kind of, how everything answers to everything else. Sue was just talking about some basic things that are just mentioned in Paul, of course. The Apostle Paul had a spirit of revelation, and he would just say things as if everybody knew that, right? He says, you realize, of course, you're going to rule over the angels, so you ought to be able to work out this court deal on earth, don't you think, right? But he would say, of course, there's thrones and dominions and principalities and powers, and everybody else was going, even Peter said, our brother Paul talks about things very hard to understand, right? But he saw glimpses into that. The prophets did in the Old Testament. And they would describe something they were seeing. Sometimes they would say it looks kind of like an ox or kind of like something. Sometimes they just said, I'm tapping out on this one. It's a creature. It's alive somehow, but, there's nothing on earth that I can tell you that it looks like that. And so there's all kinds of things out there. The worst thing you can do is get to try to shrink God down to fit in your box, right? Now, in that huge realm of celestial beings, that's not temporal beings that are confined to the time-space continuum, but celestial beings, they're just operators in two kingdoms. There are no neutral beings out there that are neither good nor bad. They're either in the kingdom of light or the rebel kingdom, the kingdom of darkness. And so all those that operate, that they're celestial beings, they're not created with mortal temporal bodies, that operate in the kingdom of darkness are called evil spirits. We tend to call all the other one angels, though that's an inaccurate term. An angel, technically, is malak. It's a messenger, and some of them are messengers. There are also men in white all through the Bible who are messengers, and they're just a different kind of being, which is why they're called men in white instead of messengers. But in any event, when you come into the kingdom of light, as Sue was talking about, we have Enoch talking about archangels. We have Daniel talking about the watchers. There's different things that are mentioned. Paul's the guy that just goes all over and, you know, says thrones, dominions, and rulers of the cosmic kratos, he calls them, rulers of the systems of the world. And then he just goes on without explaining them, as if we all ought to know that, right? He's sort of like Ian Clayton, if you've ever heard him teach. But anyway, now, what do we really need to focus on? How many think it's a good idea to focus on what Jesus told us to really focus on? Okay, so of all those things out there, there's a reason that he said, I want you to go everywhere and preach the good news that the authority of heaven has invaded earth and heal the sick and cast out demons. That's one specific genre of evil spirit. And we're all told to do that. If you're a disciple of Christ, that's the deal. You go everywhere, you preach the gospel, you heal the sick, you cast out demons, you raise the dead. That's something all of us should. All of those things are things that we should pray into, and as we grow in maturity, learn to do. All right, so what is a demon? Okay, a demon is a disembodied evil spirit of the ancient dead, the antediluvian age. Sue said something else the other day, and obviously she reads, she was talking about something out of the book of Jasher. I don't know if you've read the book of Jasher, but the Bible itself tells you to read it, so that might be a good place to start. Also, the book of Enoch, which thoroughly defines the fall of the Watchers, the cosmic rebellion. He talks about the legal right of demons to roam the earth until the great white throne judgment. He talks about all those things, and he says that that evil population we were talking about, which was, remember, somewhere between 5 and maybe 30 or 40 billion people before the flood. The earth was very populated, and all those people except for 8 were unspeakably wicked. Now, that's hard to sort out. How many think the world is pretty dark today? How many know there's a heck of a lot more than 8? That are serving Jesus, loving God, trying to remain faithful, right? So we are talking about a dark place, and I mentioned this yesterday, but the definition by Scripture is every intent of man's heart was only evil continually. And so either that was but just unthinkable evil, or God was grossly exaggerating in that little verse. I'm thinking it was evil at a realm we can't even identify with, because the earth was ruled by the fallen watchers, evil spirits that were perverting and manipulating mankind. All right, now, when they were all killed, Enoch, again, tells us, along with Peter and Jude, that the fallen watchers that were led by Semyaza and Azazel, those fallen watchers were bound in a prison in the heart of the earth until the end of the age. The Bible specifically says that, talks about it. But all of the spirits of the antediluvian age that were only evil continually, now their physical bodies were gone, And we had to decide what to do with them, right? The book of Enoch talks about that, and that Satan, which is just a title that means adversary, but we're talking about Lucifer, the fallen one. Satan said to God, you're more powerful than I am, and you're hoping that mankind will serve you with through their own will, which Sue was talking about. But he said, but I implore you to allow the spirits of the evil one that have chosen me to remain as evil spirits in the earth to test the hearts of men. This is in the book of Enoch. And by the way, the book of Enoch was part of the canon for 364 years. That means all of the church fathers read it, just like they read Jude and 1st, 2nd Peter and all that other stuff. And I don't want to get sidetracked on that, but you should think about that. You should think about the fact that the council that decided the book of Enoch couldn't be in the Bible anymore was the Council of Laodicea. They were lukewarm 100 years before they did that. And by the way, if you're wondering if they had profound Christian judgment, they also said that women couldn't speak in a church meeting. They couldn't even sing. And they said that no one could remain seated in the presence of a bishop. I mean, my point is, they were a full bubble out of plumb with anything that we would believe in. So they tried to the Council of Laodicea tried to edit all of the eschatological books out of the New Testament. And in that battle, they only succeeded with Enoch. But they didn't want 2 Thessalonians to be in there. They didn't want Jude to be in there. They didn't want the Revelation to be in there. But the point is that in all the fighting, the only one that they compromised with, they said, well, Book of Enoch is kind of a wild book. We'll take that one out of there. So people often ask me, do you think the Book of Enoch should be in the Bible? I really don't care if it is or isn't. But I think when all of the apostles of the Lamb, including Jesus Christ, thought that he was a godly prophet and that the information was accurate, that works for me, whether it's in the cover or not, right? So I'm just saying that because, you know, I teach on this a lot, that there is no theologian in the world that has any explanation for demons. Enoch is the guy that tells us where they came from. Why didn't Moses or anybody else comment on it? Obvious answer, why should they? Enoch already covered it in detail, right? And so that's why Moses, he just hits in a very cursory manner some key points, like what happened in Genesis 6. That's a key point. And he just kind of mentions it, because Enoch covered it in detail, all right? So having said all that, that explains why those beings desperately want to get inside of a human body, because that was their origin. They had a body in the days of the flood, and for a long time, by the way, because people lived a long time back then. But now they have become what are called specters or ghosts or disembodied spirits, which means they cannot express themselves in this realm, in that the time-space realm, unless they do it through a human body. And so they make a high bid to try to influence someone to the point that they can come into them and express their evil will through them. Now, that's what we call demonization. It's not demon possession. There is no such thing as demon possession. And it's not a biblical word. Check it out. There's six words in the Greek for ownership. They are, none of them are ever used in regard to the activity of an evil spirit. That's why in your Bible, you'll see that it says demon, and then it's hyphenated, and in italics, it says possessed. Well, you may have not even noticed that. If you did notice it, you may have just wondered, I wonder why possessed is italicized. You have to go to the translator's notes in the front of the Bible, and somewhere in microscopic print, it will say words that appear in italics are not in the Bible. We just stuck them in there to confuse everybody for the rest of their life. You know, honestly, it's ridiculous. But it's demonic. And I'll tell you why. Again, Augustinian theology has caused a lot of problems in the body of Christ, because when you take away the realm of our great adversary and say demons are not a problem for Christians, then you've deceived yourself, which is a very bad place to be. But you've also taken away any possible remedy. If you do not know what the problem is, how are you going to fix it? And so what happens instead is the Western Church just pounds people down for stuff they're struggling with, instead of being compassionate and praying for them and say, hey, you know, that's the work of the devil. No Christian should carry around shame. No Christian should carry around fear. And the big majority of the body of Christ is filled with fears. But no Christian should carry around depression, or on and on it goes. Anything that is not the fruit of the Spirit is the fruit of unholy spirits, right? And how those spirits work is they work against, as we said yesterday on snake and scorpion spirits, they work against the faculties of our soul to try to gain place. And that's why the Bible says, don't give place to the devil, okay? The Bible doesn't warn you not to do something that is impossible. Does that make sense to you? When the Bible says, don't give place to the devil, it's because you can give place to the devil, and it's a big bummer when you do. So the Bible says, don't do this, right? So I was talking to you about the origin of demons, and just now I used the word devil. The majority of the church don't understand those two terms. They don't know why they're in the Bible. They don't know why they're used. They don't know even if they're different. And so we need to understand this, because we're supposed to be casting demons out of people and resisting the devil. How are we going to do that if we don't know what it is, right? Okay, so all these disembodied evil spirits have been left to test the hearts of the sons of men. And they've been doing that for 6,000 years, right? And those same spirits are called devil. Let's look at the slide. Why is Satan? Satan is just, again, a title that means our enemy. And when it's capitalized and used in this setting, it's talking about the prince of darkness, which is Lucifer, the defrocked cherub that covered the throne of God. But he's called the devil, and spirits who work with him are called devils 27 times in the New Testament. And so what does that tell us about them? We already know they're evil. They're only evil continually. There's no demons that ever have a good, noble, or kind thought. No demons are ever going to come by and say, you know, we've been giving her a really hard time, and he's a pretty nice guy, has a cool car. We're not going to bother him anymore, right? They don't do that. They're only evil continually, and they harass us, and they look for ways to inflict their evil against the two parts of our being that are vulnerable. And that's our soul. Those are categorized in Ephesian magic and in Jewish exorcism writing. They're categorized as snake spirits. One of them's talked about in Acts 16, right? Python spirit. And also they attack our physical bodies because they come to steal, kill, and destroy. And so those are spirits of death, sickness, disease, weakness, which is also not of God. These chronic fatigue. See, this is my goal. I'm hoping for the body of Christ to get to a place that they don't keep giving free hall passes to the devil to eat their lunch and pop the sack on their head. That happens all the time. People are like, I'm thinking of a lady that I really like, a pastor of a church in California, and she says, "Oh, I can't do missions. I can't do this. I can't do that because I got chronic fatigue syndrome, and so you know she can only work about 12 hours a week." Well, I compassionately, you know, I get what a bummer, but it's not okay, and to just accept that. Christians shouldn't do that. They just should say, wait a minute. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Remember what Jesus did when he saw that the temple was defiled? It made him angry. He braided a whip. He went in and he took out everything that defiled the temple. You think he's changed his mind about you? No, he doesn't want anything in you that defiles the temple. But our mindset is so compromised. It's like, oh, yeah, you know, I got this, I got that, and I will probably die early. And Paul says, you know, people don't understand redemption. And because of that, many are sick, many are weak, many have already died. What he was saying is if they knew the truth, they wouldn't be sick and weak and dying. That's what Paul was saying. And so anyway, so Jesus said, hey, all these myriad of spirits have been evil spirits that are demons, disembodied evil spirits, ancient. They're roaming the earth. Jesus talks openly about that. He says if a demon is cast out, it wanders around looking for another victim. So he tells us about these demons. But then, as the slide says, 27 times, these kind of evil spirits are called devils. Now, I want you to understand why, because it's very, very significant. Okay? The word is transliterated diabolos. It means to throw through, at, or against something. And it's diabolos. It's a compound word. Well, we still have in use on the planet bolos. And that's a gaucho with a set of bolos. And what bolos are is they're weights with strong leather thongs that they swing and throw at you. In North America, we use lariats. But a lariat, you know, you can't throw a lariat more than from here to you, you know. You got to get right up on there. Bolos, they can throw them clear over to the exit sign and take a gazelle down. And this is an ancient gaming device. It's a hunting device because Diabolos is hunting our soul, but this is an ancient hunting device that illustrates for us why evil spirits are called devils. All right? What does it mean? It means to throw at, to throw against, throw to entangle. So bolos are a set of three or more strong cords joined at one end, having round weights attached to the other end, used to hunt prey by throwing it at them to entangle them. And that is depicted in a movie called A Winter's Tale. I don't know. We haven't had real good luck showing these videos, but if this comes up, let me just say this. Hollywood spent a bazillion dollars illustrating why evil spirits are called devils in a movie called A Winter's Tale. In the movie, Colin over here, he's a young man that is searching for truth. But he's working for the devil, which is Russell Crowe in the middle there, right? And so he starts out working for the devil, but then he meets Jessica over here, and she represents perfect love. And so it's a great story because it's about the heart of man being entrapped in sin but looking for the love of God. So it's a great story, and it also has a cool angelic horse, so that's awesome. But Anthasar is the cool angelic horse that comes to try to rescue him. Now, in this clip, if it shows it, it will show the devil coming against him and says, you can't quit me, boy. He said, I've been darkening souls and crushing miracles for a long, long time, and you'll never get away from me. And then the demons, represented by the men in black, they surround him, but in order to portray this, Hollywood did a great job of showing the bolos. And so what they do is they wrap him up. He can't get away. He falls off the horse. And then they throw the bolos and they trap the spirit horse. Let's just see if that will play. Can you play that? No. Okay. Oh, yeah.
Quit me. You don't quit me, boy. I've been blackening souls and crushing miracles for longer than I can remember. Well, let's see what we're going to do with you.
Now here they come. Watch the bolos in use. There they are. Wrap around him. He can't get away. He's trapped.
He's getting that white dog alive.
And then they do the same thing to the horse, and the horse can't get away. Okay, so now I showed you that because that is what Hebrews 12 is about. You don't know that because you didn't live in that culture. They knew that. When Paul said, let us free ourselves from the hindering weights of the sin that so easily entangles us, they all knew what he was talking about. He was talking about resisting the devil, right? We don't know that because we're Westerners and we have no idea what the entangling weights are. But that's where the devil gets his contemporary street name, right? I'll show you one other thing because this is really important for us to talk about and understand how it works. This is going to use another video clip, and it will show you the power of thought casting. Did I tell publicly about the witch that came to try to destroy the church, or was that in the private room? Okay. Well, anyway, remember the prophet that was looking over and saying, hey, knock that off. She was thought casting. And they do that because they employ demons who are thought casters. And the good news is the kingdom of hell does not have any unique powers. I thought it was, you know, interesting as Sue was going through the judgment of the gods of Egypt. How do you not get fired when you're the Pharaoh's magicians, and instead of making frogs disappear, all you can do is make more? It's like, really, guys? Gee, that was helpful. We'll have to give you a bonus. You know, I mean, what a ridiculous thing. They never could remedy anything. But anyway, So the kingdom of darkness, they don't have any unique powers. And but in this whole concept of where the devil gets his street handle, why Lucifer, our great adversary, Satan, why he's called the devil is because of his power to put thoughts in your mind. Okay? And the entanglement, we saw it with the guy getting wrapped up with his arms and legs, the horse getting the legs wrapped up. But what you and I get wrapped up is our minds. And even whether it's a snake spirit or scorpion spirit, the let's take this wonderful Christian lady who's just decided, don't you hate it when that happens, but I have chronic fatigue syndrome, and so the rest of my life I can only work 10 or 12 hours a week. What has happened? She's believed a lie in her mind. And if the devil can deceive you in your mind, he can control you in the details of your life. Think of how the first deception happened. This being which was a glorious, awesome being of some kind. It was it was chief over all creation. That this thing that came to Eve, right? It wasn't. No woman in here is going to talk to a snake for long, right? You might hit it with a rake, but you ain't going to talk to it. You're sure not going to throw in with it. hey, Adam, it's been real, but I'm with the snake now. Forget it. It was some kind of a glorious creature of some sort. And it's, of course, Lucifer is the head of the genre of dragons. And dragons, so anyway, I don't want to get sidetracked, but I was going to say dragons still breathe fire. So the point is that the fiery serpent deceived her. And if the devil can get you to think wrong, the devil can get you to act wrong. Let's all try saying that together. If the devil can get you to think wrong, the devil can get you to act wrong. So what the lie was, and it's always mixed with enough truth to get you to swallow it, but what the lie was is that if she ate from the tree, she would become like God. Now, she was walking in the evenings with God for the purpose of getting to know him and to become like him. So anyway, the devil always tries to get you a shortcut, which winds up being a very long, miserable cut. But the deception is a shortcut to get where you want to go. And that happens all the time. But as soon as she believed that lie, that God is keeping that from me, instead of God being a loving provider, protector, now she believed a lie about the character of God. And when she believed that lie, of course, she gave place to the devil. And she acted wrong. She ate the apple. Why? Because she believed the lie. Now, that's true of everybody. People, you sin because you are deceived. Paul talked about it in Romans. It says, sin first of all deceived me to destroy me. And we all have those scars somewhere in our hearts, right? We all know what that's like. But nobody says, I think I'll just rebel against God, have a miserable life, and go to hell. That's not what people think. They always, it's like the drug dealers. They always think this is going to turn out good. Drug addiction has never, ever turned out good for any human being. And yet millions of people believe the lie. Same with alcohol. And so so these spirits, they're speaking to us all the time. The language of the spirit realm, this is true of the kingdom of God and of the kingdom of darkness. The language of the spirit realm is called telepathy. You don't hear it with your ears. It goes straight from the mind of God into your mind. That's how Holy Spirit speaks to you. And there are hundreds of thousands of Christians who are waiting around to, like, you know, to hear God audibly. In fact, you hear it in testimony, like, God spoke to me audibly. It's like, that's because you're spiritually deep. Right? And God had to say, hey, you're so dead, I'm going to have to come down into the carnal realm and shout at you. But that's not his goal. His goal is not for him to become like you, but for you to become like him. So you start hearing the voice of God. I told you about Kevin, and he was going to paddle his son. His son was under this demonic barrage, the little boy that kept hearing in my mind, I am a homosexual. What's that? Diabolos. There was a curse released against him. Curses are empowered and enacted by evil spirits, by demons. And so there was a generational curse that was based on a blood covenant. That boy, the release time was when he was at Bar Mitzvah, when he was 12. He wasn't Jewish, but anyway, he was just turning 12. That was the trigger. Those demons attacked him. And that poor little boy was constantly hearing that voice in his head. You're a homosexual, you're a homosexual, you're a homosexual. Now, what happens to a little boy that believes that lie? First of all, they begin to identify with it verbally. First, there's mental assent, then there's verbal assent, and then there are actions that embrace that. And I've been pastoring for over 40 years. I've talked to lots of people that say, I've always been a whatever. I've always been a child molester. When I was a kid, I was thinking about molesting other kids. Or they'll say, I've always been a homosexual. How many have heard that line? I was born this way, right? What they actually mean is they were born with a vulnerability that the devil attacked. And from their earliest memories, they were hearing thought casters. It happens all the time. Sue mentioned this. Some of the worst attacks that come against human beings are through the mouth of another human being. But what has happened to that human being? They have usually, inadvertently and unknowingly, they become a mouthpiece of the devil. Anybody ever heard that happen? Let me tell you a story about that. I had gone to teach in an island setting, and it was a Quonset hut, and it was a tropical rainstorm, and the power went out. And I don't know if you've ever been in a metal Quonset hut in a tropical rainstorm, but it is loud. And so, and the power went out, and I didn't have a microphone, so I just waited for the rain to get over, and it didn't get over. And the guy running the thing said, hey, you know, I just got on the radio. This could last for 4 days. You're just going to have to go ahead and teach. And it was like, you know, and he says, you go ahead and teach without a mic. And I said, how am I going to do that? He said, well, we'll just gather in a circle around you and talk as loud as you can. Really bad idea. Because 4 days later, I had ruined my vocal cords. And so I came home sounding like Kermit the Frog. And Cheryl said, what happened to you? I said, oh, I hope it'll go away, but it didn't. So I went to the doctor, and he said, you ruined your vocal cords. He says, there are big, gnarly calluses on your vocal cords. And now, then, and you'll, we'll try to operate, but that's your only option. You're not going to get better, and we're going to have to operate, or of course, God could heal us, but... and we always pray for that. But in the meantime, the church, you know, it didn't work for me to be a preacher and sound like Kermit the Frog, right? So we prayed, and I went in and I said, hey, if I do this operation, how sure are you that you can fix it, and how long will it take to recover? And he said, I'm pretty darn good. I think I can fix it completely. And you can recover in a month. And so I told a pastor's group that I was praying with, pastors being amongst the most carnal people I've ever known, but that's a different conversation. But anyway, So with these pastors, I said, would you guys take prayer for me? It was bad. I'm telling you, it was bad. I sounded just about exactly like that. But anyway, I croaked it out, and I said, would you please pray for me? I ruined my vocal cords, but I have an operation tomorrow, and he thinks he can fix it. And I'll have to be on voice rest for about 3 weeks. And I'd just like you guys to pray for me. I'd rather be healed right now. And I'll just tell you where I'm at on all that stuff. I'm marked D, all of the above. Like, what should you do? Should you rest, take medicine, pray? Yep, D, all of the above, right? I just like, there's an old saying, if you find yourself in a fair fight, your strategy sucks, right? So just get everything in your corner, right? And try to just kick a lung out of the ranks of hell that are coming against you. So anyway, we were praying and doing all of the above, you know? So I just wanted them to help pray. This pastor in town, I just finished, and he said, excuse me, I know what's happening here. And I felt like, I just told you what's happening here, right? But he said, I know what's happening here. He says, you have cancer of the larynx. I said, no, I don't. He said, yeah, he has cancer of the larynx. It happened to my cousin, and the doctor will find that out when he goes in. They'll have to take his voice box out. He'll never be able to talk right again. He'll have a little box here. And what we need to pray for is for the Church Glad Tidings to find a new pastor. Now listen, you know, I try to be a gentle guy, but I almost went Old Testament on him. But now what was happening? That was a curse. It's called a word curse. It doesn't matter if you know you're doing it or not. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. And you will be judged and held accountable for every word you speak. Whoops. Exactly. Because the word created everything and still does. We can create good emotions in people by our words. We can create terrible emotions in people by our words. And other things. We can put permanent, except by the grace of God, we can put permanent scars on people's souls through our words. Now, remember, the language of the spirit world is not communicated audibly. In the spirit world, it's thoughts. And that'll change your life if you get that. I tell people, I used to didn't think I could hear from God very well. Now I'm doing pretty good, but I recognize it's God if I think a thought that's smarter than I am. It's like, yeah, that had to come from heaven. You know, it's way above my pay grade, right? Or a gracious, redemptive thought. That God is speaking all the time to us, all the time to us. And it's sort of like the radio is right now running through this room. There's all kinds of information. And you just need to dial to it, right? And so that's what we need to do. By the way, epineurology, which is studying what happens outside the brain that affects it, they say that your brain synchronizes. It's like a dial turning that tries to pick up frequencies every 10 seconds. 6 times a minute, your brain, without you knowing it, your brain is just putting up its antennas like, anybody talking out there? And God is always talking. That's why we are talking about we are sons. The Bible says those that are constantly led by Holy Spirit, how does he lead us? By that voice. That comes from the mind of Christ. Why do you think the Bible says you have access to the mind of Christ? Because we do, right? That mind is always sending impulses into our mind. We call them telepathically. That means there's no audible noise involved in them. They're just as real as, well, they're spiritual, so they're more real than audible noise. But they're all over, and God wants to talk to you all the time that way, wants you to learn. That's a God thought, wants you to learn to tune into that. And as you learn to do that, then you can be a weos, son or daughter, that is constantly led along by the voice of the Holy Spirit. Now, talking about evil spirits and how to fight them, we need to understand that they do the exact same thing, only their influence is always evil continually. And it can be subtle things like, guy's a jerk, right? Or whatever. I mean, they're just thoughts, or they don't like you. My wife, some of you know my wife. My wife is the most loving human being I've ever known. And it amazes me that people will say, I'm going to leave the church because Cheryl doesn't like me. And the first thing I say, you mean me, right? You surely don't think that about my wife. But that happens. And what is it? It's diabolos. It's devils. Remember, a demon is what they are in essence. A devil describes the power that they have against humankind. It comes through their deceptive thoughts that are put into your mind. And that happens too. Now, it can happen to you anywhere, right? Anybody beside me ever been singing holy, holy, and all of a sudden you go, holy schmoly, where'd that come from? You know, rebuke, rebuke, rebuke. take captive. It can happen right in the middle of a church service, right? There are demons all over the place. And they don't mind coming into a church service. They do it all the time. And trying to mess with people, and their spirits of deception, and they all have slightly different powers, but the way they attack us are the same. Is the same. It's thought casting, and you might want to jot this down. But it's generally what their purpose is to bring deception in one of three primary areas, causing you to believe a lying thought about God. That's the initial temptation of Eve, a lying thought about God. The other area is a lying thought about your relationship to others. I was just telling you, people say, Cheryl doesn't like me. And I've told people, Cheryl, I think she might pray for the devil to get saved from time to time. She loves everybody. There's nobody that Cheryl has ever not liked. But yet, that there's that lying thought. She likes everybody except you, right? And so we need to learn that this is how the kingdom of darkness works. So lying thoughts about God, lying thoughts about your relationship with others, and lastly, lying thoughts about yourself. I'm no good. I was doing one of these seminars a few years ago, and we have one the last week of October at Yuba City. If you want to come to the Isaiah 61 Summit, it's all week long, 9 in the morning to 9 at night. It's called Isaiah 61 Summit, okay? It leads up to the 30th, the day before Halloween. Should be a ripper. But anyway, so I was doing one of those, and at those, you know, we teach a lot. We just hit some of the highlights here, but I do a lot of teaching. And then we pray for people. And our whole church loves to pray. Deliverance, inner healing, physical healing, they're inextricably wound together. It's all is the power of redemption unringing hell's bells, however hell has figured out how to attack a person. And it should happen all the time in the body of Christ everywhere. In fact, it used to. We were talking about that, Papa. It used to be that when somebody was saved, the church fathers, when someone was saved and they confessed faith in Christ, they would go straight into deliverance. Back then they called it exorcism, but they'd go straight into deliverance. And one of the early bishops said in one of his writings, they were talking about how to disciple people. And he said, well, Well, first there has to be a commitment to Christ as Savior. We get that. And then he said, we have exorcists in the church that work with them until they can no longer sense any demonic presence in their life. And then they come to me. And he said, I do the same thing. I do I pray over them and ask some questions, and then he said we go on to teaching them about the doctrines of Christ. Now, the landscape of the church in America would look way different if we still did that. But we don't, because people have been confused about this whole thing, and even though the Bible specifically tells us not to give place to the devil, Augustinian theology says it's not possible. If you're a Christian, you're magically shielded from all evil. I told you I got kicked out of the apostolic network that I was a part of, because I went back when I figured this out, and I had hoped that they would, listen, be teachable. I think it's a beautiful thing when you find out new revelations, and we should always be in that column. We should always be learning, because none of us have even scraped the surface of an understanding of God. And so I just thought, oh, wow, we're all wrong about this. I'll go back, and they'll be happy that I was so kind to come back and show them the error of their ways. Didn't turn out quite that way. But anyway, the apostolic head of that denomination said, David, I believe that when someone prays to receive Christ, if they're sincere, it permanently and completely breaks all the power of evil in their life. Oh, yeah. We could all just be somewhere on a beach in Mexico or something if that were true. But I looked at him and I said, what? He says, that's what the Bible teaches. I said, Dick, no, it doesn't. What about all the verses about spiritual warfare? Oh, that's not about anything inside you. That's, rebuking the, Diana of the Ephesians, something. And I said, okay, well, what about this? I said, you teach the biblical pattern of redemption through Israel. Right? First the natural, then the spiritual. They're the church in the wilderness. We're the Israel of God. And the Old Testament has natural stories with eternal spiritual significance. And that's why Paul says all those things happen to them as examples, and they're written for our admonition. So anyway, again, I was way involved in this Bible college, right? And so I said, well, we teach that the Passover blood represents Jesus Christ, the Passover lamb that is shed, his blood is shed for us. Well, of course it does. I said, okay, I'm with you. They went through the Red Sea, and that represents water baptism. He says, oh, yeah, that's plain. I'm reeling him toward the boat, Yeah, that's plain. And I said, then the Shekinah presence of God came into the camp and never left them. And that's baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he said, yes, that's exactly right. And I said, okay, but the Bible doesn't end there at Sinai. And he said, well, what's your point? And I said, my point is they were saved, water baptized, baptized with the Spirit, in order to prepare them for the wars of Canaan. That was the whole deal, right? Is your inheritance is out there, and you need to be saved, baptized, filled with the Spirit in order to kill the enemies and to drive them out of the promised land. You know what he said? He said, the promised land is heaven. I said, really? With all those Nephilim giants that ate people? It was filled with Nephilim giants that devoured the inhabitants of the land. That's why it scared the bejeebers out of those Jewish soldiers, right? And he said, well, every type breaks down. And I said, well, Dick, you are ignoring the wars of Canaan. It's only a major doctrine. of the Old Testament. It's about our inheritance. By the way, your inheritance, the promised land for us does not represent heaven. It represents us becoming, we are sons, just like Jesus. He didn't wait to go to heaven to be pronounced a we are son and have access to all the inheritance of his father. That happened while he was on earth. He's our standard and our example in everything. And so anyway, so that's where all of us are right now, is the wars of Canaan. If you'll read the book of Joshua, the theme is victory through faith and obedience. That's the theme of the book of Joshua, victory through faith and obedience. The next book is Judges, and the theme is failure through compromise and unbelief. And if you look through that, most of the tribes compromise their inheritance. Well, that's what Jesus says. Some are 30% fruitful, some 60% fruitful. The goal is to be 100% fruitful and to get the full meal deal, to get everything that God has planned for us. And so then where does this whole thing with evil spirits fit in? The evil spirits are the ones that are trying to keep you from inheriting the great and precious promises. That's why, by the way, they're called hindering spirits. Jesus had spirits try to hinder him. Paul said, "I've sought to preach the gospel in your land, but Satan has hindered me." Okay, and he also said to the Galatian church, "You started out well in your faith, but you've been hindered." That's not the cranky next door neighbor. That's the spirit realm that is trying to keep you from ever realizing your potential. And again, we have great authority and victory over them, but let me just say this. They have done well at that in the West. Hindering spirits have caused people to stay immature, have caused people to sell out their birthright, and reduce Christianity to some boring thing that you sing kumbaya behind stained glass and wait for Jesus to come back. That is not what the Bible teaches. But if we believe that lie, and again, there are deceiving spirits that are constantly, they're trying to get you to compromise in what God has called you to. And they're always lying to you. They constantly are telling you you can't do that, or nobody really likes you. If they knew more about you, they would hate you. There's all kinds of things, you know. But they all go back to spirits, evil spirits, that try the hearts of the sons of men. And they can really hinder us, and they can really cause problems. And so Jesus said, when you are extending the kingdom through the earth, and that's the whole idea, you realize the cosmic war broke out in heaven, and the good guys won, right? And Lucifer and the star angels were cast out, but shucky darn, they were cast out to the earth. Wish like anything that had gone to Venus or somewhere. But anyway, if you understand this cosmic conflict, Lucifer calls himself the prince of the powers of the air. The powers of the air are those rebellious spirits. Again, they're not demons. They're much, much more powerful than demons. Case in point, Gabriel, who's a face angel, an archangel of God, was sent directly commissioned by God to take a message to Daniel. How many, we've been talking about authority here. How many think that that's some serious spiritual authority? Archangel Gabriel with a message from God. Do this, Gabe. Right? That's serious authority. And he was withstood for 21 days by one of the princes, one of the powers of the air. He's identified as the prince who rules over Persia. And that's hard to even imagine, that Gabriel was withstood 21 days. But you know what he said? When he came to Daniel, who wondered what had taken him so long, right? he said, well, I left, I was dispatched the day you started praying, but I've been hindered for 21 days. And then he said, and I would still be there. But Michael came. And when it comes to spiritual warfare, Mikey likes it. And so Gabriel's a messenger angel. Michael is a kick-butt warrior angel. I got to see him one time in the clouds, and I almost wet myself. I'm being serious, man. It's just like, oh. It's an amazing being. But anyway, so that's spiritual warfare, but the kingdom of darkness, they are trying the hearts of the sons of men. Those are the demons, the disembodied evil spirits of the antediluvian age, who are only evil continually and don't have bodies of their own. And then there are more powerful beings who are the gods of the earth that we were talking about. The Shivas and the Dianas, and there's a bunch of them, and a bunch of them in America. But anyway, there are those, all kinds of other beings, thrones and dominions and yada, yada, yada. But they have established a perimeter in what the Bible calls the air. It's not space, which is equivalent to the heaven, but they've established a perimeter. Why? To try to separate man from God. And so that little dynamic that is put in the Bible so we'd understand how it works, I don't think that Gabriel's the only one that they try to keep out of this realm. They have to do some warring to get through. And our prayers empower that. Let me tell you a cool story. When the corona, and again, I'm just, this is my story. So the coronavirus thing, we prayed about it. We thought, nah, we're going to crank it up a notch. We're going to keep meeting, praying, do more prayer meetings, and we're not going to shut down. So that's what we did. All right. And we've been praying aggressively against fear, because I don't even call it a pandemic. The issue, I know there's a virus, but the big issue is fear. My mom's 86. She just got it, was sick a few days. I called, said, hey, mama, you know, she said, oh, I'm fine. She said, no flu's going to take me out. And I said, atta girl. So the point is, yeah, there's a sickness, but we've had sicknesses in the human arena ever since the fall. But this one is being perpetrated through fear. That's why we call it a panicdemic. It's panic. Everybody like, oh, don't breathe on me. Oh, don't, you know, right? That's the problem. And so we've been praying, God, let your people rise up. A fearful world needs a courageous church. And so that's what we've been praying about. So anyway, we got this guy. One of our ministries is Feather River Men's Center. And there's this big old boy, the Pelican Bay guy. And he's all tatted up and he's rough, but he's a jewel. He's just a wonderful guy. And he's in that Feather River Men's Center. And he's a trophy of God's grace, but big as a barn. And he came in, and one of our buildings, we call it the Well, and that's where we gather to pray all the time. And it's my favorite building, because you always feel the presence of the Lord is just really wonderful there. So we have it always available. That you can come in, and there's worship music going, and there's communion elements, and you can just come in and soak and pray and whatever. It's a really cool place. So he came in to make sure that everything was in order, because they do that on Fridays. They help clean, straighten the church. He walks in, and all he saw was a big feathered curtain. And he's never seen anything in that realm before. And he just like, whoa, I'm hallucinating. And he's had some serious experience with that. So he went back out into the lobby and like, what's going on? And he's praying. And he thought, I'm going to try it again. So he opens the door, and there's these big feathered curtains. But when he looks at it, he thinks, oh, my gosh, those are wings, these two big, massive wings all the way up to the ceiling. And so there's a side door, and he goes around, and he goes to the side door, and he looks in, and he sees this huge angel that went all the way to the ceiling. And he couldn't see his head because he was like this, and he was leaning on the handle of a big war club. He said it was a major, big, like Viking-looking war club, and he was just standing in the middle of the well where we pray all the time for God to send his angels to destroy this plague of fear, and he was standing like this. And when he came in the side door, the angel just turned and looked at him. Well, again, telepathy is the language of the spiritual realm. And so he just looked at him and said right into his mind, he says, I'm just resting. And David's just like, and so he said, I'm just resting. And he turned back down like this. And then David thought, didn't say anything out loud, but he thought, I wonder what he's doing here. And the angel answered, right? Because thoughts are the medium of communication in the spirit realm. So he thought, I wonder what he's doing here. And he says, oh, I've come in answer to your prayers. He says, I've been destroying fear in California. Big old hammer. Like, oh, that's so great. That's so great. So the power of thought casting. Now, this is going to show you a clip, and then we'll quit. Sorry, I've talked to different people about I'll tell this story or do that or whatever, but we just didn't have enough time for it all. So anyway, I want you to see this because George Lucas brings the phenomenon of thought casting. And I was telling somebody the other day, I just wish the church was at least as spiritual as Hollywood. Wouldn't that be nice? But, you know, Hollywood believes in the supernatural realm. That's why. Did you know the movie series Supernatural is going into its eighth season, 8 years in a row? Because people are hungry for that. They're not hungry for the great American religious enterprise. They're hungry for spiritual realism. And so anyway, they have spent however many dollars to include this whole idea of thought casting as a Jedi Knight power. And the truth is, it is a spiritual power. But in this, just if you're not a movie watcher, the entire galaxy is looking for this little, what do they call it? Looking for this little droid robot. It's called a droid. The entire galaxy is searching for it. And now they come into town with that droid. And the stormtroopers, they walk right up. I mean, they busted him. They're right there. But Obi-Wan, he looks at the guy and says, these are not the droids you're looking for. Now, the stormtrooper instantly embraces that as his own thought. You got that? He's not hearing it as a thought from Obi-Wan. He's embraced it as his own thought. So Obi-Wan says, these are not the droids you're looking for. And the stormtrooper, the captain, turns to his soldiers and says, these are not the droids we're looking for. Because he thought that's his thought. Happens all the time. Happens with fear all the time. Two, you feel fear and you own it. Don't do that. When you feel fear, rebuke it. When you feel fear, which you should because you're an emotional being, when you feel it, rebuke it in Jesus' name and say, God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and love and sound thinking. And then shout really loud, Rock Kusak Amats, or something like that. Do yay God, do something. Don't you... we allow evil spirits to victimize us all the time. Don't do that. That's why the Bible says resist Diabolo. Resist Diabolo. And he'll flee from you. Okay, so what you're going to see, and I want you to pay attention to it, because that's the story that I was telling you about. The spirits, you're a homosexual, the little boy had, he was just a little boy, you know, no fault of his. He's just trying to figure out how to make life work, but he had owned that thought. If God hadn't intervened, he would definitely have become a homosexual. No doubt about that. So let's take a look at this clip.
How long have you had these drawings?
About 3 or 4 seasons.
They're up for sale if you want them.
Let me see your identification.
You don't need to see his identification.
We don't need to see his identification.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
These aren't the droids we're looking for.
He can go about his business.
You can go about your business.
Move along.
Move along. Move along.
Podcasting. That's it. Now listen to what they say here.
Those jobless, disgusting creatures. Go on.
I can't understand how we got by those troops. I thought we were dead.
The Force can have a strong influence on the weak-minded.
Okay, so that's your Jedi Knight secret to take home with you. The Force can have a strong influence on the weak-minded. That's why we have to guard our mind and take every thought captive. Wouldn't that have been a good opportunity for the stormtrooper to say, wait a minute. No, I want to see his identification. Well, wait a minute. Who says they're not the droids I'm looking for? We've got to take every thought captive and make it submit to Christ. Now, if we learn to do that, we will be light years advanced in ground level spiritual warfare. That's where it is. You fill your heart with the word of God. You embrace the truth and you resist the devil. How? You don't say amen to his lies. You don't give place to evil passions and influence. You just say no. And of course, you don't get involved in evil activities. All those things make you vulnerable to the kingdom of darkness. So just to conclude, what Jesus has called us to do is to understand these things and to go everywhere preaching the good news. What's the good news? The authority of heaven has come to the earth, and it's far greater than the authority of hell. That's really good news anywhere in the world. And then to demonstrate it, you heal the sick, you cast out demons, and raise the dead, which is the ultimate expression of resurrection life being available on the earth. Okay, that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Bless you.
Okay. So, what you think? Good stuff, yeah.
Bless you.
Absolutely.
I have those teachings that he's talking about, and everybody online, you can go to, what's the name of the church again? Yeah, Glad Tidings, and it's Isaiah 61 series, and the Wheel Sons. They are excellent. Everyone needs that series if you can get a hold of that. But just as humble as he is, he doesn't have it here or anything. You have to go online and get it.
I'll second that, because I also have listened to the whole series, and this is just like part of, just a small part of that. So it is good. And hopefully Herb and I will go in March and just see the whole thing live and just interact with that. October? Oh, and March, he says, October and March. So we are going to break for lunch. We'll be back at 2:30. And we do have more question and answers. So if you have a question We couldn't get to all of them, but we'll get to the ones we can. Everybody have a good lunch. And no food truck today.